Honourable speakers, deputy speakers, members of parliaments, distinguished delegates, a very good evening to you all. I know it has been a busy day, but also a very productive day with a series of workshops on important topics throughout the day. But this is a very special evening, and it is a great pleasure for me to welcome all of you to the inauguration of the CPA Commonwealth Parliamentary Lecture Series. This is the first time that CPA is introducing this lecture series. The CPA Commonwealth Parliamentary Lecture Series is a key component of the new program strategy of the CPA with the purpose of discussing key and timely thematic areas on implementation of political values enshrined in the Commonwealth Charter. In the coming months and year ahead, the CPA Commonwealth Parliamentary Lecture Series will discuss such issues as just and honest government, the elevation of poverty, fundamental human rights, international peace and security, global economic development, the rule of law, equal rights and representation for all citizens regardless of gender, the separation of power, the right to participate in free and fair elections, and many more. And it is important to have your suggestions to carry forward the lecture series and how we would want to design it and how to make it more effective is, of course, open to suggestions to the secretariat, and we can work that out. The CPA lecture series, it is hoped, will provide as its hallmark an international platform for distinguished current and former parliamentarians and other key international leaders to express their views on issues of specific importance to the CPA membership. Ladies and gentlemen, this evening we have a very distinguished speaker with us. It is the Right Honourable the Baroness D'Souza CMG, and I will very briefly introduce her because she is already very well known. Frances Gertrude Claire D'Souza CMG PC is a British scientist and Lord Temporal. She was educated at St. Mary's School, Princethorpe, and went to the University College London to read anthropology, from where she graduated with a BSc in 1970. She subsequently undertook studies at Lady Margaret Hall, obtaining the degree of Doctor of Philosophy in 1976 from the University of Oxford. From 1973 to 1980, she worked for the Nuffield Institute of Comparative Reproductive Physiology. She taught physical anthropology at the London School of Economics as well as the Oxford Polytechnic, now Oxford Brookes University. From 1985 to 88, she was an independent research consultant for the United Nations. In 1999, Dr. Souza was invested as a companion of the Order of St. Michael and St. George. In 2004, D'Souza was created an independent peer as Baroness D'Souza of Wychwood in the county of Oxfordshire. She sat as a crossbencher in the House of Lords, where she was the convener of the crossbench peers from 2007 to 2011. On 13 July 2011, D'Souza was elected Lord Speaker of the House of Lords and began her new role on September 2011, which she held until 31st August 2016. This evening, she will speak on the theme, and the theme of the lecture is the promotion and implementation of the Commonwealth's enduring political values, challenges, and opportunities. I have to say that in this particular 62nd CPC conference, it seems to repeat that every time there are two women sitting or three women sitting with one gentleman. It has happened at the inaugural session, it has happened at the CWP inaugural, and even today at the lecture series inaugural we have the same, and we are very pleased about it. I have the very distinct honor to invite Right Honorable the Baroness de Souza CMG to deliver her lecture. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Madam Chairperson, Secretary General, distinguished speakers and delegates, members of the diplomatic community, good evening to you all. And I have to say that I'm absolutely delighted to be here and indeed deeply honored to have been asked to give this lecture. My confidence was slightly dented. I was coming down in the lift a little while ago, and a gentleman in the lift said to me, well, what's on the program next? And I said, well, I think there's going to be a lecture. And he said, oh, no, not for me. So I'm really rather relieved to see that some of you have actually turned up. So thank you so much for doing that. But I think that, in a way, it's quite difficult, despite, you know, the optimism of this meeting and the good words that have been said about the Commonwealth, it's quite difficult to be that optimistic about the world to today. How should we characterize the world we currently live in? We have conflict, despair, inaction, the politicization of humanitarian aid, short-termism, globalization, growing disparity between the rich and the destitute, political instability, and the potential for even greater cataclysmic change, environmentally and otherwise. So the question that inevitably must be asked is, what is to be done? We feel, I suspect, helpless in the face of such huge issues, and one response is to cast the world situation from our minds and to focus on our own nations and our individual lives, if only because these are, to a greater extent, within our control. But my friends, not all of us can, nor should we, do this all of the time. We have responsibilities. By virtue of being part of the human race, we, particularly those gathered in this room this evening, have the extraordinary good fortune to live within a democratic space, however imperfect. We do not have the luxury of hiding our heads in the sand. This is easily said, but what should we be doing, how and where and when? I hope you will agree that there's never been a time when the diversity and unity that the Commonwealth represents has been more needed. This evening I want to talk about the potential of networks, of individual parliamentarians and parliaments to implement some of the lofty and indeed noble ideals that the Commonwealth has crafted over the last 25 years and more. And I want to end by asking your agreement to take on that responsibility in your own countries in specific ways. The CPA has a long and distinguished history. It is now in its 105th year. Its role, I don't think I do need to remind you, but I'm going to nevertheless, is to connect, develop, promote, and support parliamentarians in analysing and implementing good governance and in the enduring values of the Commonwealth. The CPA is like a trusted friend, always there and often taken for granted. And indeed, the Speaker of one of the parliaments present here today said to me yesterday, "We're happy to be together." Well, yes, that's right. But friendship requires commitment and renewal from time to time in very real and practical ways. And this conference is one of the many opportunities for the family of Commonwealth Parliaments to do so. What is striking in looking at the work of the Commonwealth as well as the CPA worldwide are the agreements it has reached on international issues as diverse as the green economy, arms trade treaty, youth participation, and access to information. Let me add some further flesh to the bones of these achievements. The Declaration of the Commonwealth Principles in 1971, the Harare Declaration of 1991, the Millbrook Action Programme, Langkawi Declaration, the setting up of the Commonwealth Human Rights Initiative and the Commonwealth Ministerial Action Group, the Commonwealth Youth Programme, more recently the Commonwealth Charter, the CPA benchmarks for codes of conduct for legislatures, as well as for parliamentarians. And in between these landmarks, there's been a myriad of reports emanating from smaller, single-focus groups, often in cooperation with other civil society organisations. So, my friends, there is absolutely no dearth of research and information and recommendations. We are replete with them. But there is a yawning gap in their implementation. We face continued challenges within the CPA, including discontent between the developed and developing nations, between small states and larger states, between tiger economies and fragile ones. And then there are the newer and seemingly insurmountable issues of radicalism, migration, and Brexit. How is the CPA, or even is the CPA, equipped to help deal with both the enduring factors which prevent it from acting to its full strengths, as well as confronting major global issues? The short answer, my friends, is that it is rather poorly equipped. This is not entirely the fault of the Commonwealth or CPA. Nearly all the international institutions are proving themselves ineffective in grappling successfully with the big issues of the world today. Quite simply, these institutions were never designed to deal with such a rapidly changing political environment. The goalposts have shifted seismically. Nevertheless, there is much that could and should be done. To illustrate this, let me go through a few examples of historical, and I'll put it in quotes, failures, despite any number of agreements to implement fully the principles that underlie membership of the CPA. Let's begin by looking at the Arms Trade Treaty. We are here, I trust, agreed that the adoption of the Arms Trade Treaty in 2013, a vital component of international humanitarian law, was an altogether good thing. The government of Trinidad and Tobago was a strong supporter and indeed was closely involved in the negotiations. All 14 of the CARICOM states have signed the treaty and 11 have ratified it since it came into force in 2014. But it is by no means universally adopted, even within the Commonwealth countries. Thus, of the now 52 member states, 27 have signed, but only 20 have ratified the treaty, leaving half of Commonwealth member states that have neither signed nor ratified. The Arms Trade Treaty, if universally adopted, would be a powerful instrument in reducing significantly the pain and suffering associated with the billion-dollar illegal arms trade. The Commonwealth could become a leader in not only creating, but indeed insisting upon greater awareness of the treaty and its aims, but in taking the lead in also ratifying it. Clearly, these are matters for the governments of the day, but in a democratic system, governments are driven by Parliament. So the question becomes, what steps have the parliaments in those member states who have not yet signed taken to insist that their government join the struggle for peace and security in the world? Next, let me look at the access to information. Governments on the whole do not welcome freedom of information laws, which they view as unpleasant intrusions to get information which in turn alters or interferes with their grand socio-economic plans, often unfavorably. Nevertheless, freedom of information laws and practice have become a consistent feature of functioning democracies. The Commonwealth was perhaps one of the earliest in 1980, if not the first intergovernmental organization to recognize the importance of people's access to information, the right to know and to be involved in decisions that affect people's lives and livelihoods. Despite earlier efforts by the CPA in 2005 and 2006, which many of you will remember, in the shape of workshops on the concept, practice, and experience of the right to information, only 20 Commonwealth states had introduced FOI laws by 2010, roughly 30% in 30 years. A lack of funds, together with other factors, precluded any forceful follow-up mechanisms, and thus there was no critical mass to convince governments of the need to take FOI seriously. For example, almost none of the parliamentarians who attended the workshops a decade ago seemed to be prepared to convince their parties to table access legislation or even to introduce private members' bills. It is reported that no private member's FOI bill has ever made it to the statute books within the Commonwealth. This rather dismal statistic gave rise to the setting up of an eminent persons group in 2011 to look at options for reform of, among other aspects, ensuring transparency and accountability in domestic governance. The work of this group, and in particular the Commonwealth Human Rights Initiative, has improved matters somewhat. One important conclusion is that it is only when parliamentarians work with bureaucrats and, crucially, with civil society organisations that obstacles can be overcome. One renowned researcher working in rural India exhorted disadvantaged communities by saying, "You seek accounts from a shopkeeper and a milkman, why don't you seek accounts from the government? The government spends your tax money. You have the right to know how it is spent." This is surely a message that parliamentarians could use in forcing through access legislation at local, provincial, and national levels. And now let me look, and indeed there's been a great deal of focus on this in this, the 62nd conference. Let me look briefly at women in Parliament. It is, I think you'll agree, axiomatic that in the absence of women in politics, the democratic conversation is simply incomplete. I also speak as a member of a chamber that has increased its female participation from 5% in 1989 to 26% in 2016. This is still shamefully short, particularly in an appointed chamber of the 30% recommended by the CHOGM, but at least it is beginning to show some improvement. So how do other Commonwealth parliaments fare in this context? Not as well as we would hope or expect. Despite seemingly endless meetings, conferences, workshops in all our regions, on the engagement of women, especially young women in political life, the result is that their engagement is still extremely modest. Why? Well, we all know at least some of the answers. Women's lesser economic power, for example. 70% of the world's poorest people are women, their cultural attitudes and factors. And above all, the fact that too many women today still live in states of poverty, fear, exploitation, and utter weariness. Though political participation is undoubtedly their right, it is perhaps unrealistic to expect such women to aspire to political leadership, even at the local level, when their primary concern remains subsistence and survival. The social conditions for political equality have first to be created. Education and skills training, both issues of ongoing development and issues to which the CPA has devoted and is devoting many resources. I might add that very recently, in fact, the day before yesterday, the Confederation of Businesses produced a report looking at the labour market in this country, and one of the conclusions they came to is that the absolute absence in this country of sufficient education and skills training of young people, which is resulting in very major impacts on businesses. So, you know, we are one of those Commonwealth countries where improvements have to take place. It is not by no means all in other countries. But let us not forget small slivers of enlightenment. Rwanda, where over 60% of parliamentarians are women, the Parliamentary Women's Caucus in Pakistan, which has, over the years, been successful in forcing through gender-balanced legislation, but also in striking out discriminatory statutes. Additionally, it has teamed up with provincial governments through civil society groups to enable women to participate at the local level. And of course, we have the chair of the CPA, who is the distinguished female speaker from Bangladesh, Dr. Shirin Chaudhary, and where the Prime Minister of that country is the equally distinguished Sheikh Hasina. In this context, I think I must mention also the important and successful Commonwealth Women's Leaders Summit earlier this year, which many of you may have attended, which concluded with strong practical recommendations in three thematic areas: violence against women, women in leadership, and women's economic empowerment. We look forward to hearing more in the months to come about the impact of these programmes. Now, having spread a bit of gloom, why don't I just outline some success stories? One refers to the rapid and full adoption of the CPA benchmarks for a democratic legislature, which the Bermuda government hopes to adopt by the year 2016. Shortly after the introduction of the codes of conduct, Bermuda set up a joint members from both Houses of Parliament Select Committee on Parliamentary Governance and Reform. An initial seminar had indicated that parliamentary practices were somewhat dated and did not constitute best practice. Reform was needed, and the Bermudans welcomed an independent platform on which to base their reform, which in turn was provided by the benchmarks for a democratic legislature. Over several years, current rules and procedures were reviewed and reformed and accepted provisionally in 2010 and finally in 2013? Well, finally in 2016. The proposed recommendation of the Joint Committee acted as a roadmap for the continuing monitoring of the reforms. While not all the recommendations on Parliament's functions and on ethical governance have been fully enacted, the important factor here is that the mechanisms by which this is to be achieved are in place and the process is in train. The second very recent innovation, second and a series of recent innovations introduced and championed by the Secretary General are designed to bring parliamentarians together and to strengthen their parliamentary networks. This initiative rests on the assumption that effective parliaments are the principal institutions of state and therefore central to achieving Sustainable Development Goal 16. This goal, as you all know, centres on peaceful and inclusive societies by means of which Sustainable Development Goals can be reached. A decade after the launch of the Benchmarks for Democratic Legislatures, CPA has gone back to look at the performance of parliaments and the impact that the benchmarks have had. The rationale, of course, is that the need to encourage public trust in parliaments and its members is very, very urgent the world over, and particularly in some countries of the Commonwealth, UK included. So the question then becomes, what lessons can be learned? What works and what doesn't work? Noam Chomsky has said very recently, last weekend, that the perils we face are greater today than at any time in history, which is a very sobering thought. So what as parliamentarians should we be doing to mitigate some of these perils? We cannot deny that there continues to be a democratic deficit, but in those parliaments which are prepared to work across party boundaries and chambers, together with forging strong relationships with the relevant NGOs and civil society groups at the local and national levels, huge progress can be made. We can demonstrate that. That has been demonstrated. Let me pose a question to you. Let me take the example of, say, food security. This is an issue that conceivably could occur in our lifetime if worldwide food shortages threaten. What are the international and multilateral organizations doing in terms of contingency planning? What do we know about what they are doing? If we don't know, how can we monitor the practicality and sufficiency of their plans? This is not just a matter for governments, it's a matter for humanity. And we, as parliamentarians, have a responsibility to make it our business. Having said that, there may well be entirely adequate plans which are being effectively monitored, but, you know, I have to say, I really do doubt it. And there is certainly no critical mass of parliamentary opinion and action at regional or national or certainly international levels to push governments into action. And I was phoned up the other day by someone who, you know, you often get I'm sure all of you did call from people who are, let us say, very, very focused on one particular issue to the point of being obsessive. But this obsessive sounded quite interesting because what he was talking about was food security, and had done a great deal of research on it to look and see whether food security plans being set up by the UN, by WHO, by FAO, are adequate. And I think that, you know, his feeling was that they are entirely inadequate. And food security is an issue that could hit us very suddenly. You need to have a major disruption in transport or distribution, coupled with maybe major crop failures, and you could have worldwide food insecurity. And as I think all of you know, that we're not terribly good at the moment at managing to get food, you know, to people who so desperately need it and who are accessible. A lot of them are not accessible, but some of them are. Bilateral and multilateral agreements need to be signed, ratified, and monitored by parliaments. MPs work best when in touch with their constituents, thereby knowing their concerns and building trust. MPs can climb mountains if they work across local, national, and international political divisions towards a common purpose. What is needed is to define that common purpose in small ways, not grand ways, which, you know, no one can quite implement, but in very, very concrete ways. There's no question that MPs working in conjunction with civil society organisations can have exponential effects. The larger issues of Commonwealth discontents cannot be dealt with unless there is a record of transparent commitment to the Commonwealth values at the national level. This is what parliaments should be doing. To do other than to take on these kind of responsibilities is to devalue parliaments, and thus also a vital pillar of our democratic systems. Before I conclude, I want to ask or wonder whether there are any people among you who will remember an event that took place in the UK on the 23rd of June of this year. If you do recall it, there may be some interest in surveying how this momentous referendum outcome might affect the Commonwealth in general and parliamentarians in particular. The short answer is profoundly, and the long answer is profoundly, but we have no real idea what the effects might be in the UK, let alone in other Commonwealth countries. At the outset, I feel that the decision to withdraw from the European Union can be viewed as a failure in regional cooperation, and this is not a helpful lesson for the world, particularly for relatively weak regional schemes. Brexit, as it has become known, will affect trade and institutional ties. But some also believe that in time, it may also offer stronger South-South cooperation and more favourable trading terms. But to balance this, let me remind you that when Britain joined the European Community, as it then was, in 1973, it was argued by Britain, by the British government, that trade with Commonwealth overseas, with the Commonwealth overseas, unlike that with the common market, held out no prospect of dynamic growth. Things may have changed, but I fear, in trade terms, not for the better. For example, the formal trade aid and investment relations with Britain of the 12 English-speaking Caribbean countries and Suriname and Dominican Republic are managed through the UK's membership of the EU, an arrangement that superseded the Commonwealth Preferences Scheme. The UK's earnings from exports to the Commonwealth are only 9.7% of total exports, while the equivalent figure for exports to the EU is 45%. Many Commonwealth countries have very deep links with the UK and via it to the EU, and inevitably there will be consequences. These could concern fatal moves to hinder all kinds of seemingly small but hugely important conventions that bind us together. For example, changes in facilitating remittances, travel, visas, tourism, investment flows, and cultural exchanges. The, with luck, temporary instability that will pervade Europe will affect other and perhaps weaker blocs. In what ways, we just don't know. Recent research has demonstrated a clear relationship between regionalism and democracy, and herein lies the clue to the role we might play. As parliamentarians, Our clear responsibility must be to renew our democratic principles time and time again, renew and strengthen our solidarity with one another, making it explicit that transnational solidarity can be achieved and that it is priceless. And to do this, we need our citizens to both understand and support these efforts, again, something which falls squarely within the remit of the members of Parliament. I cannot emphasize too strongly that the path towards such understanding lies in education, especially public education, citizen engagement in the political process, and a further commitment to participatory regionalism. Anything that falls short of this commitment will deepen democratic deficits and increase mistrust. So while Brexit is a sad departure from a regional experiment, this setback should be used to propel deeper regionalism between Commonwealth countries led by parliamentary cooperation. Let it not, I beg of you, be an example of negative symbolism about regionalism. I hope I've pointed out that while the Commonwealth, and especially the CPA, is a potential force, it is not always working to its best ability. Strong and overt commitment to and implementation of the values it holds are desperately needed. This in turn can alert a somewhat cynical wider world that there is a network of nations that aspire to the highest standards, and in doing so, provide leadership. You must all of you know that there is strength in working as a body, in cooperating with one another across the Commonwealth and across political divisions. Parliamentarians, each and every one of us, has a responsibility for people, not governments. And that responsibility necessarily means championing measures that make the lives of individuals better and hold the government to account. Parliaments working together immediately increases the probability of success. It is up to us. I'm delighted to mention here that the innovative programme streams introduced by the Secretary General, Mr. Akbar Khan, go some way in continuing to strengthen the role of parliamentarians. And it is with great delight that I learn of these new programme streams, and I'm sure it is to your great delight as well. And I'm referring here to the leadership programmes, masterclasses, the Hot Topics Forum, roadshows, and the setting up of a CPA clearinghouse to facilitate interchange between CPA branches. The potential for change and renewal is really very great. The Commonwealth provides an ideal forum for the exchange of experience and for exploring the best ways of transforming obligations under international law into the domestic legal framework. To do this, the parliaments of the Commonwealth have perhaps the most important role to play. We've heard a lot in the last few days about the good things of the Commonwealth and the CPA, and in particular, what makes us special. It is only, however, continued pressure from parliamentarians on behalf of their constituents that will enforce policy changes. Our legal, cultural, and political heritage should form the most solid basis for cooperation. The worldwide body of parliamentary associations, if united on the vital global issues, both small and large, would emerge as strong, capable of world leadership, and above all else, committed to ethical governance. This is an ideal we should all strive for, and never has the time for the overt practice and adoption of such an ideal been more urgent. Thank you.
Thank you, Baroness D'Souza, for an excellent, thought-provoking presentation. It depicts contemporary global issues that dominate the discourse and are extremely relevant to our lives. You have not only posed the difficult issues, but have also discussed a way forward and how parliamentarians can play their role. Thank you very much for the presentation. Thank you.
Baroness D'Souza, distinguished guest, has agreed to take questions from the floor with regard to her speech. So we're going to open the floor now for questions, and there'll be some roving mics. So Who would like to start with any questions?
Baroness D'Souza, thank you very much for your lecture this evening. My name is Steve Minnick and I'm a member of the State Parliament of Queensland in Australia. My question to you, and you touched on it with your comments in relation to Brexit, there appears to be a move in the Western world in particular from open trade, free trade, to one with the rise of nationalism of closed borders. How do you see this playing out in relation to not just what you touched on with Brexit, but the greater Western world, with this move towards nationalism and a movement away from free trade?
Okay. Should we take a second question, which I think was over here?
Thank you so much, Honourable. Highly inspiring. I've just one question concerning the issue of research, and we have rightly pointed out that most often than not, there's so much research being done, but there's less in action. So there's a gap between the laboratory and the field. This is particularly so when it comes to food security, as well as probably skills training for the youth. To your experience as an academician, as well as a politician, where is the lack, and what can parliamentarians do to bridge the gap between that which is researched and that which is being practiced? Thank you.
Thank you.
Ms. Susan, would you like to take those two questions?
Yes, I mean, how many hours do you have here? The question on sort of Brexit and the move towards nationalism away from free trade is such a huge, huge issue. And I don't think that there's anyone, certainly in the UK, that has really any idea of, you know, A, whether it's going to happen, how it's going to happen, to what degree it's going to happen, and what the impact is going to be. I mean, I think there are, and I think this arises really from the fact that, you know, it's difficult to overemphasize the importance of this move that has been made in the UK. Because I don't think anyone had any idea of the sheer legal and economic depths of our links to Europe and through other countries, with two other countries through Europe. I mean, there are Commonwealth countries that have individual relationships with the EU. But I mean, I have no idea how one is going to begin to deal with that. And you know, the people who I think voted, I mean, you can obviously tell that. I have to say, when I was Lord Speaker, I never had a single political view because I wasn't allowed to. So I'm really indulging in having political views at the moment about almost everything. And you can tell from what I'm saying that actually I think Brexit was a bad idea. I mean, really a bad idea. But in particular, it was a bad idea because there was this stream of sort of arrogance, really, in the government that they didn't necessarily have to do any preparation because they were going to win. And that is a hugely, hugely irresponsible thing to do with a country. That said, of course, as you know, there are several issues outstanding at the moment which would suggest that the actual process of leaving and therefore dealing with, I want to say something about nationalism in a minute, dealing with nationalism and away from sort of free trade, having sort of specialized exceptional free trade agreements may take decades. And it may well be that, you know, things will carry on, but if I were a businessman, and I'm a woman, I'm not, I think that what the business sector, and particularly the finance sector, looks for is a degree of stability, and I think we're in for a rocky time, which means political instability. So therefore, it's a sort of, you know, it's a descending cycle, really, because I think there will be a number of major industries, including the financial industry, which will move. Just want to talk a little bit about nationalism, if I may. Again, I don't expect you to sort of be au fait with all the ins and outs of what's going on in the French election, but let me tell you that there is an election going to come up in next year. And there is a very serious possibility that the far right could win. And everyone is watching that with great interest and some concern. If that were the case, Marine Le Pen, that would be totally the end of the European project. The European project could not survive. Now, There's discontent, there's also the Dutch election coming up, and then there'll be the German elections later. Friends of mine in the Foreign Office, and indeed from the research community, believe that what will emerge from this, the strength that will emerge from this, is Germany. And that the world over will no longer be calling the UK, certainly not France, but they will be calling Mrs. Merkel, or whoever replaces, I think, Mrs. Merkel. And Germany will become the center in terms of political stability, economic stability, and economic growth. That, to my mind, is dangerous. It's what the European project was all about, was to actually limit, you know, the sort of the growth of nations in view of our sort of past modern history. So I'm wandering into all sorts of areas, but I think nationalism, the growth of nationalism, is it's a very naive thing to say, but it must be a product to some extent of extreme frustration of the majority of people in the world. And right at the beginning of my lecture, I said that the gap between the people who are really, really making it and those who are not, I mean, the growth of destitution. We have food banks in this country. You'll know that. We've got food banks. And there are hugely respectable people who just can't make ends meet who go to food banks. I mean, in the 21st century, in the UK, one of the richer economies in the world. So I think there is a deep, deep discontent. And of course, parliamentarians are tarred with that brush of discontent because it is felt that they're not doing anything, or not doing enough, let us say, in order to try to work on that particular discrepancy. There was an occasion in the House of Lords very recently which caused a huge constitutional furore when the government, the last government, not the current one now, but well, the same government but a different prime minister, introduced working tax credit cuts. Working tax credits and child tax credits were credit schemes to young families who couldn't quite stretch their income in order to allow them, you know, to meet their bills. And because we have an austerity government, the government decided that what it was going to do was to make these cuts. But it didn't do it by means of introducing it as legislation. It did it by means of its executive orders, by secondary legislation. And it is very, very rare, and I'm sure this must be true in all your parliaments, for a chamber, whether it's an upper or lower chamber, to confront government over secondary legislation. The convention is that you don't. And the House of Lords did actually confront the government. And what happens with secondary legislation? You can't amend it. You either accept it or you deny it, and it falls. And the reason why they did so is because a report had just come out a couple of days beforehand from a very respectable financial monitoring organization to show that 650,000 families would immediately move into destitution if these measures were introduced. And so what the Lords did was to block it, or at least what they said was that they asked the government to think again, and what the government decided to do was to drop it altogether. And it provoked massive constitutional crisis, you know, that, you know, the House of Lords, an unelected body, should not be able to thwart government policy and everything. But it's an example of, if you really, and I mean, people from, it was a massive majority from all sides of the House voted this down. So, I mean, I'm just giving that as an example of how parliamentarians working together and across party divisions can actually change policy. I mean, this is sort of minor matter in the history of world events at the moment, but it was quite big at the time. Let me talk about research and how we bridge the gap. Well, I mean, it's a question of implementation. You know, there's an awful lot that's going on. I mean, let's not pretend that there aren't hundreds and hundreds of civil society organisations all across the Commonwealth and beyond, which are working day in and day out at, say, grassroots level to make people's lives better. And a lot of that depends on policies which have been adopted by governments. What I think is perhaps a shame, and I may be wrong on this and I don't know enough about it, is there doesn't seem to be an adequate amount of togetherness with these civil society organizations, either within a locality or a region, to create that critical mass which would be a force for change. And all of you here, I'm sure, know that there is enormous sort of, you know, competition between non-governmental organizations, particularly with regard to funding, and they don't like to be seen to be, you know, treading on each other's toes. But there is, you know, what we want are movements to implement rather than individual research efforts. And again, I mean, you know, we have a very major aid budget in the UK from the Department for International Development. It's very big, it's billions. And there was recently a vote where we would keep it at 0.7% of the GDP, which some people are very uncomfortable with. There is a huge question, I think, as to how you can actually spend that amount of money in implementation. It is much easier to give a university £5 million or £10 million to set up a three-year project to monitor countries, you know, from North Africa to South Africa, from West Africa to East Asia, than to actually work with smaller organizations in implementing some of the things that we know work. Because it takes time, effort, personnel. It's expensive to deal with small organizations. I set up some time ago a school in Afghanistan some years ago, and it's doing terribly well, touch wood. And I approached DFID, and they said to me, if you can't use 10 million, we can't help you. And it seems to me that, you know, what one's doing, I mean, I'm paraphrasing, they didn't exactly say that in those words, they more or less. And I mean, here is a country that desperately needs education of women and girls, skills, you know, vocational training, and the school is doing all that. But, you know, it's too cumbersome. So I think really there is, as again I said repeatedly, I think probably ad nauseum in my talk, that if there is a willingness for parliamentarians to work with civil society organizations, NGOs, and to be prepared to oversee and monitor the implementation, again, at local levels, a lot can be achieved. And maybe that is happening in lots of areas, but it's not happening enough. It's a difficult question.
Question over here. That's brilliant presentation, firstly, but also, ma'am, you are raising a very powerful question in the observations you are making about what are the likely impacts of Brexit. Mm. It seems to me that it is suggesting that we must look at our regional formations, that they do not become, at least as perceived by people on the ground, elite pacts that preclude useful domestication of useful regional issues. So in any regional formations that exist, that are nucleic in their formation, we must be careful about what we are constructing, that we do not arrive at a situation where people rise against what otherwise is useful collaboration. This is what I'm interpreting what you're suggesting. I want to ask whether, is there a way in which we can tease out more from what you have already said about people perceiving the frustration in the manner that you suggested and possibly leading to what happened in Britain?
It's a good question.
There's one private members bill that I remember in South Africa that we passed, one in the Commonwealth, but it's a small one. The overall point you are making is a useful one. But I do want to suggest that perhaps because of the cultures we come from, where we often give precedence to doing things together rather than individually, including inside political parties, even if they fracture. This is why you will tend to see, in some of countries like those, limited number of individual legislation coming as private members' bill, even if it exists by way of allowment. People have had to go to court in my country in one instance where someone wants cannabis to be examined for use for medicinal purposes. Mm. As a private member's bill, as we speak, it is under examination, a small committee is looking at it and so on. So it is a combination of those cultures, although they are provided for in the overall constitutional makeup and so on, but in practice, because of the culture of how things are done, it happens slightly differently and so on. But thank you very much for a stimulating lecture. I found it very useful, yeah.
Thank you very much. This is Ari Zaman. I'm one of the directors of one of the Commonwealth accredited organizations, the Commonwealth Business Women's Network. And I just wanted to pick up on your point. You specifically referred to women's economic empowerment and collaboration. You specifically referred to women's economic empowerment and collaboration. And my question, therefore, is really twofold. One is, there are two very concrete ways that can give practical effect to what you're talking about in terms of the Commonwealth family. I think 89%, the World Bank did a presentation to women's affairs ministers in Samoa 2 months ago, and they were saying that 89% of our Commonwealth countries have one or more laws against women setting up or progressing a business. I mean, there are significant legal barriers to women's economic participation, which make little sense in a recessionary or contracting environment. And the second is procurement. You know, less than 1% of procurement, private sector or public sector, whether it's Manchester, Multan, or Melbourne, Montego Bay, goes to women-owned businesses. Less than 1%. So I think the point I'm making here and the question, therefore, is there not an opportunity, not just an opportunity, but an imperative, for parliamentarians, Commonwealth women parliamentarians, and Commonwealth parliamentarians in general, to work much more effectively, much more robustly, with the Commonwealth family, the Commonwealth Business Women's Network, the Commonwealth Enterprise Investment Council, the Commonwealth Entrepreneurs Network, there are other networks, to actually raise visibility about these issues, build a stronger coalition about changing that, and actually, to your point, lastly, monitoring the impact of that moving forward. I mean, that's a question and both an appeal.
Could I take your question first, and then I'll come back to you? I mean, everything you say, I completely agree with, and it is within our power to do something about this, okay? And I really must, again, refer back to the experiment, as it were, in Pakistan with the Women's Parliamentary Caucus. And indeed, CPA UK, because I really found out about this during a CPA visit, and we were all mesmerized by what was going on there, working at the provincial level and the kind of sort of commitment there was of these women parliamentarians. Though these things change because, you know, politics change. But the CPA UK took this up with a vengeance. And what we actually did was to, or what Andrew did, was to set up a series of meetings and workshops where we were determined to sort of bring together women from South Asia, from the Asia region, from Bangladesh, from Nepal, India, Pakistan, Afghanistan, Sri Lanka. I'm not sure all of them were able to come at the time. I think India was going through a budget crisis, but anyhow. In order to have a workshop showing what works, you know, we can have these conferences. They're wonderful. It's lovely to see you all, et cetera, et cetera. We all spout great ideals, and we all bemoan the fact that not enough is happening. But workshops where someone stands up and says, these were our problems. Women couldn't have access to credit. There was investment coming in massively to the country. And women were not. This is being done, and is being done extremely successfully in countries other than Pakistan. I've seen a lot in India. Really successfully. I mean, I think, you know, the sort of the failure rate in sort of payback for these sort of credit schemes is something like 2-3%. I mean, they are ridiculously successful. Why is it that we can't get a world movement of ensuring that women in rural areas have access to credit? Why don't we use the models that have been set up, because they are phenomenally successful? And, I mean, you're nodding, but I'm asking you, why can't we? Why can't we do that? Does anyone have experience here of women's credit unions at very local levels which are effective? Yes?
Yes, I think it's the Honourable Foko Dadiza from South Africa.
Yes?
Would you like to say something, Honourable Dadiza, about credit unions, women credit unions?
I will come back to your question.
Yeah. particular stage, because their deposits were growing, we had to actually facilitate from the government side and have cooperative legislation that would allow, you know, for such instruments, as well as working with the Reserve Bank to ensure that some of the instruments of banking, you know, are amended in order to allow for that sector to operate. There may not be many, but they are there, and some of them have actually gone beyond the period of 20 years.
Do you have the necessary framework now?
We do now have the necessary framework. As I say, that we have got the Cooperatives Act, which allow for, you know, for, we call them village banks or credit unions, but also within the normal banking law, it does allow for the operation of the credit unions and facilitated by specific clauses within the broad banking legislation. For instance, the Women's Development Bank, which has had a period of about 25 years now in operation, and it's operational in the various provinces of our country, is actually operative.
Fantastic.
Thanks.
Fantastic. Can I just go back to the... Yes. So I was going to go back and answer this question here. Oh, no. Dr. Chaudhary.
I actually came down from there because the air conditioner blow was direct and I was having a bit of a problem with it. So I'm here. but I want to just contribute and share with you that supporting credit facilities for women, there are quite a few different models in Bangladesh.
Yes.
We have collateral-free loans for women from the Reserve Bank. It's a scheme of Bangladesh Bank, the central bank, and collateral free is very important for women because most of the time they cannot come up with collateral. So that is a big scheme. There are other small and medium women entrepreneurship events where they get a lot of support funding from the government for the small and medium entrepreneurship, SME loans. And then we also have the saving scheme, which is one farm, one house, where it is mostly a grant, not even a credit.
Yeah.
And that it is a matching grant from the government, which is given to women. And it is also a kind of a cooperative model where they take that money, do what they want. And now also a banking system is being established for them to save that money. So there are quite a few different models of giving credit and allowing access to fund for women in Bangladesh.
Can I ask who, how did these, I mean, in any country, how did they begin? Did they begin through the work of MPs, working with civil society groups and with banks? How, I mean, why,
most
are the models
government coming? Initiatives, government policies.
Government initiatives?
Yes. Yes.
Oh, that's interesting.
Thank you.
Can I go back to our gentleman from South Africa?
In our case, actually, they were not led by any public representative. It was really grassroots.
Grassroots. But then supported by the government.
It was grassroots initiative and supported by government
sure.
at a later stage. But in their yeah. own formation, they actually started as yeah. local initiative, given the need that was experienced
right.
at a community level.
Right.
And the frustration, in part, particularly at a rural level, that the banks were very far from where they were.
Yes.
And second,
mobile phones, eh?
And secondly, the requirements for credit and collateral, particularly where tenure security was an issue, because we still have a dual tenure system where you have got communal tenure system under trust by government and also freehold. So you'd find that in the banking environment, they would want collateral and, you know,
yeah.
where they can be able to yeah. attach if you don't pay. But at a community level in the village, the land is held in trust by the chief, and you can't say this house, no matter what value it is, can be an asset that the bank would recognize.
Yeah, I mean,
so
I mean,
it was out of that need in particular.
So, I mean, there are many different models, but the thing is that what one wants to see is a great deal more implementation. Can I just go back to the question that you asked? Is there anything we can do more about sort of the frustration that people feel? I mean, that is a very large question, and it would take a very long time to really sort of delve into it. But we could possibly have a sort of, you know, small conference called frustration, question mark, you know, and how we deal with that. I mean, I do think that some of the aid agencies, I mean, I'm quite critical of some of the aid agencies, having sort of worked with aid agencies for a long time, because I do think that people living at local levels make very intelligent choices. They have to. They can't afford to make wrong choices. And very often, I think major aid agencies, particularly some of the multilaterals, don't fully recognize and implement this idea that people got to feel that they own a particular project. And indeed, something that should be rooted in the community. Ideally, what aid agencies, it seems to me, humanitarian development agencies around the world should be doing is not setting up projects, but simply supporting what small projects exist within communities, saying, we see you're doing this, it's working, we'll support it. Slowly, carefully, gently, not imposing, supporting what's already there so that people feel ownership. I'm assuming you want to move on.
Thank you, Baroness D'Souza. Ladies and gentlemen, we're going to have to wrap up in about 5 or 6 minutes. So Baroness D'Souza has very kindly agreed to take 3 to 4 final questions.
I'll be brief. I know that there's a queue and it's getting near to dinner time. In terms of some of the content of your speech, you mentioned weakening, potentially, of inflexible and non-dynamic global organisations. You've managed to also tie in the populism and nationalism point very nicely that the gentleman over there made. And if we look at Trump and if we look at Le Pen, if we look at what that impact is going to have on blocs such as the European Union, and the effect of peacekeeping that has demonstrated quite significantly. There are huge global shifts, seismic shifts, as you yourself stated, that are occurring. And for us here today as delegates and representatives of parliamentary organisations, I, as a new member and a new parliamentarian, will be looking to the CPA for some leadership in terms of how we are all going to manage these global shifts politically. And as you have said, there has never been a more important time that we get our leadership roles correctly in place. So my question, briefly, is what role has the CPA in a post-transitional Brexit world?
Okay. Here, take your question.
First of all, my congratulations to CPA, and I really appreciate for starting this lecture series, which is a hallmark decision. And thank you so much for your informative lecture, and which covered almost all the topics. In my personal capacity, I'm indebted for all your support to my Women Parliamentary Caucus, and you know, you as a Speaker of the House of Lords, the support you extended. And also, with your help, we could have caucuses in the entire region, you know, in the Asia region with her support. My question again will be that, yes, you know, at that time I was in authority and I could, you know, form this caucus and we could come up with so many legislation. And, you know, now the legislation is there, the laws are there. What I see the difficulty is, in fact, there are 3 difficulties which I see here. 1, implementation. 2, implementation. 3, implementation. And, you know, we have been attending, you know, these conferences. We come here, we share experiences. I agree, there is a lot of responsibility on the parliamentarians. And when we go back with the new spirit and, you know, and over there. But again, when we speak of separation of, you know, power and separation of every institution, you know, the parliament can do, they can enact, they can make laws, they can deliberate. But when it comes to implementation, it is the responsibility of executive. And that's the governance. So, you know, unless there is, you know, the government themselves, they don't feel accountable. They don't, you know, if they don't want to implement it, it is very difficult that, you know, those laws which are there, we have it in our books. Yeah. But then to have it really, you know, happening on ground, it is not possible without the executive really, you know, unless they want it. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So one is that. The other about the, you know, the economic empowerment. Yes, you saw the, you know, example, the model in Pakistan. There were two other steps which we took. One was the Benazir Income Support Program, which was, you know, the small stipend sort of, which was, you know, given to destitute women. And the other was giving land, agricultural land, to these widows and, you know, destitute women. Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
If Baroness Souza is willing to take those two first, those questions first, then we'll take two last questions.
So okay. Your question about sort of, you know, shifts in sort of power blocks and regional blocks. I mean, this is in a way what's so frightening because. What is going to happen in America? Where, you know, the so-called pivot. About 18 months ago, I went to a sort of think tank in America, the Ditchley Foundation in America, who was looking at these kind of issues. And, you know, that was then and this is now. And it's completely different now. I mean, the idea that we actually have, you know, a president who... a would-be president who is able to personally appoint people who will follow his particular trajectory of building a relationship with what was the Soviet, now Russia, and possibly China. And I mean, and as you know, all that's going on in the South China Sea and the difficulties there with sort of not only Taiwan, but also with Japan, it is terrifying. It is absolutely terrifying. And, you know, is it not also true that he said that he will abandon the TPP, which, as you know, has taken years and years and years to set up? There will be a vacuum. What will fill that vacuum? Well, your bet is as good as mine, but I would think that China is not going to sit on its haunches and wait for things to happen. You know, and that again is another seismic shift. Now, your question, of course. Sorry, I'm wittering on. Your question is, what can we do? Why don't we have workshops, very specific ones, with parliamentarians who are becoming educated in thinking, futures thinking, about precisely these sort of issues? What if? What if? But I mean, what we need desperately is information, and at the moment we don't have it. I mean, what would be the point in having a workshop now? I have no idea what Trump's going to do come January. No idea. No idea what France is going to do come the election in March. Is it March? March. So, I mean, we have to sort of think. There have to be lots of things. Lots of people are doing research, but again, there's no body of it. And I don't know. I don't get the feeling that government is taking into account. Maybe it is, but there are three separate departments of people who are dealing with so-called Brexit and all the sort of, you know, consequences of that. I'm not entirely sure they're talking to one another. That's one of the things that governments don't do, is talk to one another, you know, within government. So, I mean, I don't have an answer. I don't have, you know, a productive, constructive answer to you. Going to Dr. Mirza's question, implementation, yeah, absolutely. there's no question that the implementation that you've been able to achieve in Pakistan has involved political will right at the top, a body of parliamentarians working cross-party, and their links with provincial parliamentarians, governments, and with civil society groups. And it's that line of communication between them, which has been allowed it to happen. And that is a wonderful model. I mean, I don't expect it will go on perfectly forever, but it is a model that has worked. And it's that sort of, you know, that connection. You know, it's a sort of sustained connection, which is good, yes. Okay.
Turn to the last two questions. It's Carl Wright, who's the former Secretary General of the Commonwealth Local Government Association, and also the Honourable Linda Reid, who's the Madam Speaker from Victoria Legislature. Carl.
The question I had relates to parliamentary business, also relating to local government. Of course, the Commonwealth Local Government Forum is, in a way, the sister organisation of the CPA. We represent the elected mayors. Last week, I had the opportunity of presenting evidence to the House of Commons Audit Subcommittee on how the UK is going to implement on a cross-departmental basis the Sustainable Development Goals, and some two very interesting issues came up. One is how can the goals be made popular in our respective countries? And there was a suggestion that parliamentarians could work together, particularly with local governments.
Did you say popular?
Made popular among the public, yes,
okay,
popularized.
Okay. Yeah.
And the suggestion was that there could be closer collaboration between local government mayors and parliamentarians. And secondly, it does strike me, maybe this is more of a comment than a suggestion than a question, that parliamentary subcommittees, which are looking at how national countries are implementing the SDGs, could be a very good way in which the CPA and the Commonwealth could cross-fertilize and indeed share good practices and experiences, bringing forward really the point about implementation, in this case, of the Sustainable Development Goals. So if you have any comments on that.
We take the final question,
Linda,
to Madam Speaker.
Linda Reid from British Columbia, Canada. You mentioned, thank you very much for your remarks, Baroness. You mentioned seeing CPA as the trusted, loyal friend. I feel that way about democracy. And the notion of the American election this time out, I can't imagine a time where I've seen the discourse plummet so dramatically. The notion of not supporting any kind of elevated dialogue. It didn't seem possible that remarks one day could be worse the next. But they certainly were through that entire process. So the women in leadership piece that I'm passionate about, that is a discouragement for women. The toxicity of the debate today in America. What is your thought?
What is my hope? Okay. Going back to Carl's question. In a way, what you're saying is something which is important, is that there is an awful lot going on. Okay, and there are people who are meeting, and there are all-party parliamentary groups, and they must be all over the Commonwealth. And it would seem to me that one of the problems always has been sort of proper communication. I mean, you all go back home, you are completely inundated with problems about your constituencies, about sort of local political dramas. You know, the last thing you're going to be thinking about when you go home is, you know, what we're going to do about, you know, SDG 16, because, you know, life moves on and one is busy. I think that, you know, what you're setting up, the clearinghouse, is going to be a really important mechanism for spreading information about what has been achieved, how it's been achieved, and we can use some of the information from your initiatives as a basis for future, very special, very focused working group meetings dotted around, whether it's to do with women working with credit unions or whatever it might be, but using that information, because we do live in a world where there's just a huge amount of information, not enough knowledge. You know, we all know that. You know, Linda, going back to what do I think about the toxic debate? Well, what do you think about it? I mean, it's. You know, there are many people who sort of, almost out of desperation, I think, who sort of felt, once he's won, it's all going to be different. He'll get there and he'll get some proper people on board and all the rest of it. I don't think so. I don't think so. And, you know, in a way, one of the things that I've been talking about today is the question of leadership. There is actually very little really good statesman-like leadership in the world. And, you know, in the days when, you know, there were people who had a sort of international reputation for being statesmen. Merkel is one of them, actually. Merkel is one of them. And I just, you know, feel that the Commonwealth as a body, I mean, I've no idea how one would begin to do this, but certainly starting with CPA, with the parliamentarians, could be a leader if it chooses very carefully what it's going to lead on. And I mean, the toxic debate that you're talking about, well, what about the benchmarks for a democratic legislature? Okay, America is not a member of the Commonwealth, but there's no harm in us letting them know about them. Forcibly. It's wrong to despair, but I do. And I'm sorry, I don't have an answer.